Welcome to the aerodynamics class once again. So today's class is an interesting class on aerodynamic forces and moments, right? The aerodynamic forces and moments, we had a discussion in the last classes that whatever we do theoretically, experimentally, computationally in aerodynamics, the ultimate idea is to calculate the aerodynamic forces and moments. Okay. So, I acknowledge John D. Anderson's Fundamentals of Aerodynamics book. Right, because most of the information what we are discussing is from John D. Anderson's Fundamentals of Aerodynamics. Okay, so before moving to the aerodynamic forces and moments, I would like to play a small video. Okay, you have seen this one. It is the kind of propeller we used to play. Do you remember when you were kids? Can you imagine this one? Like you just give a rolling moment and the propeller rises, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this propeller toy, we use it, you know, and we create a force and so that it lifts. Right, so it is lifting is actually an aerodynamic force which is created because of the shape of this toy, right? So okay, that's all. We will go to the aerodynamic forces and moments. Okay, so like that propeller toy, let it be a propeller toy or a complex Boeing 747 airplane. Boeing 747 airplane, if you see the flow over the Boeing 747 airplane, will have a complex three-dimensional flow field around the wings, fuselage, engine nacelle, tail, vertical stabilizer, engine cowling, landing gear, whatever you take, there is a complex flow phenomenon, right? That we know. So it is necessary to calculate the aerodynamic force. Of course, aerodynamic force, if I say, it means that both aerodynamic force and moments. Now, let us think about a similar phenomenon, right? Like the aerodynamic resistance offered by an automotive vehicle traveling at some speed in a highway. If you see, this also has the complex flow phenomenon, right? Like the body, the flow over the body, the air or the wake region from the car which is moving in the front, and again which the another car which moves now nearby this car. I hope you might have experienced when another car overtakes you, when you open the window, you might have experienced some kind of difference in the air pressure. You may not have thought about that as a air pressure, but you might have experienced that difference if one car overtakes or if one big truck overtakes your car or when you travel in a bike. You could have experienced the pressure from the bigger vehicle nearby the bike. Like that, you might have experienced the various change in the pressure around the body, right? Now, the beauty of aerodynamics lies here. Whatever you take, whether it is a propeller toy or if you take a complex Boeing 747, 757, whatever it is, or take MiG, Mirage, and light combat aircraft, Tejas, fighter aircrafts, or automotive vehicle, or the fan which rotates in your roof, or if you have a table fan, or if you take any bike, right? Whatever you take, the aerodynamic forces and moments on the body are due to only these two basic sources, right? One is pressure distribution and another one is shear stress distribution. The ultimate goal of the aerodynamics is to know the pressure distribution and the shear stress distribution. That's all. Okay, I can put some limitation here, limited to the low speed subsonic aerodynamics probably, because when we go to the high speed and the supersonic, then the shock wave comes into picture and we need to think about the effect of shock. And in the hypersonic flow, we need to think about the thermal effect, and hence we call that hypersonic flow as an aerothermodynamic problem. So all those things comes later, but basically the aerodynamics, the aerodynamic forces and the moments are due to only these two forces called pressure distribution, shear stress distribution, right? So I used to say in all aerodynamics class, whenever somebody asks a question, why there is a drag in aerodynamics, why there is a drag? That is because of pressure distribution, shear stress distribution. Why there is a lift? That is because of pressure distribution, shear stress distribution. Whatever question anyone asks on aerodynamics, the implicit or explicit answer is pressure distribution or shear stress distribution, right? That is the beauty. So no matter what you want to calculate, the basic is from the pressure distribution and the shear stress distribution, right? Now, we will look a little deeper into that, right? Say, the only mechanism nature has for communicating a force to a body moving through a fluid, air or liquid, or pressure and the shear stress distribution, right? So that is very clear. So both pressure and the shear stress have the dimensions of force per unit area, and hence we can add both and we can say the pressure and the shear stress distribution. Now you see, this is an aerofoil, right? So this is an aerofoil, right? You know about aerofoil. You have already seen and studied aerofoil in Introduction to Aerospace Engineering, and hence there is no need to discuss further on aerodynamics, which is a streamlined body, right? So in the aerofoil, the pressure distribution, say the pressure acting perpendicular to the surface. Now, if you consider this particular location, the pressure acts perpendicular to this surface. Now here, it acts perpendicular to this surface. Similarly here, this acts perpendicular to this surface. Okay, so all these location, the pressure, surface pressure distribution is like that, and you can measure any number of points. While you come back to the university, I will take you to the aerodynamics lab, and you will see, you will appreciate the pressure tabs around the airfoil, and you will be calculating the pressure force and all. Okay. Similarly, the shear stress, which is acting tangential to the surface. Say, for example, this particular location, this is your tau. Similarly, here, your tau will be something like this. And here it is like this. Here it is like this. So the shear stress acting tangential to the surface. That is what we need to remember. Okay. Now, you already know what is angle of attack alpha, correct? Is it fine, Aruna? Aruna.
Yes, sir. We know, sir.
Yeah, you have studied the angle of attack alpha. So let us consider V infinity is a free stream velocity, and when there is a V infinity and you have an airfoil, you know the resultant force acting on this direction. So the airfoil will try to move in the resultant direction. Right? Most of the time, we aerospace engineers or aerodynamic engineers think in that way, that whenever there is a V infinity, the airfoil moves upwards. No, the airfoil won't move upwards. The airfoil move only in the resultant direction, R. So here, of course, we have a moment M. Right? We will see how the moment acts and the resultant force and all those things. So you have a resultant force R. Okay. Now let us take it in this way. I just extended this chord line, right? So I extend that chord line, and the chord line is now extended, and the angle between the chord line and the V infinity is the angle of attack, right? Right? So angle of attack alpha, and the C is the chord length, that you know already, correct? And because of the V infinity, the resultant force acts in this direction. Now we always calculate the lift force, which is perpendicular to the free stream velocity, drag, which is parallel to the free stream velocity. Please remember, the lift and drag which we measure, and not measure, which we solve, we say that this is, the drag is parallel to the V infinity and lift is perpendicular to the V infinity. Now you have a R is a resultant force, right? So if you consider with respect to this particular chord, then you solve that, say this is an axial force A, and here it is a normal force N. So normal force N and axial force A are the two forces which we used to take for R, right? We solve R in perpendicular to the chord, that is normal, and axial is tangential to the chord. Okay. So in aerodynamics, we have only resultant force. We aerodynamists solve it in X and Y direction, and we call that as lift and drag. Okay. Now, say the lift component, right? So there is a lift component and there is a drag component. So lift component is perpendicular to V infinity. Lift component is perpendicular to V infinity. And the drag component is parallel to V infinity. But normal force is a component perpendicular to C. What is C? C is chord. And A is an axial force, right? So it is parallel to the C. So you need to remember, lift force is perpendicular to V infinity, drag force is parallel to V infinity. And normal force is the component which is perpendicular to the chord. Axial force is the force which is calculated parallel to the chord. Normal force is perpendicular, axial force is parallel. Now, angle of attack is defined as alpha is equal to the angle between the chord line and the V infinity, which is free stream velocity. And alpha is also the angle between L and N, right? And between the D and A. So here you have alpha, right? Here you have alpha, right? You need to remember, it is very easy, and you can solve also, right? In the trigonometry, we might have studied all these things, right? V infinity, alpha, and here L and N, the angle is alpha. D and A, the angle is alpha. So finally, we can write a geometrical relation between these two components. Say L is equal to N cos alpha minus A sin alpha, and drag is equal to N sin alpha plus A cos alpha. Right? Now, the source of aerodynamic lift, drag and moments on a body are the pressure and the shear stress distributions integrated over the body. So, if I calculate the pressure force E and the shear stress tau for every component, every location, then I integrate this to the whole surface, that will give me the drag and the lift force, right? So, a major goal of theoretical aerodynamics is to calculate the pressure and the shear stress for a given body shape and the phase stream, and thus it yields the aerodynamic forces and moment. Okay, so aerodynamic forces and moments are very important points, right? And we need to always say the sources, right? Sources of the forces are because of the pressure and the shear stress distribution. Now, let us go little further. Let us consider rho infinity and V infinity be the density and the velocity respectively in the free stream. Now, the density and the velocity which we are considering, say, assume we have an airfoil and you have a velocity V infinity, and rho infinity is a free stream which is far away from the body. I mean that the far away from the body, it means that the velocity is not affected by the presence of the body. Okay, so we define this as the dimensional quantity called Q infinity, that is dynamic pressure. Q infinity is the dynamic pressure that you might have studied already in the basic courses from fluid mechanics and introduction to aerospace engineering, right? So the dynamic pressure is always having a unit, which is Newton per square meter, or in many, in the old Anderson book itself, it was mentioned, you know, in the English units, like pounds per square foot. So please note, this is a dynamic pressure. So when we have dynamic pressure, we can represent the coefficient of lift, coefficient of drag, coefficient of normal force, coefficient of axial force, coefficient of moment in a dimensionless way in terms of lift force, dynamic pressure, and S is the span area, right? S is a span area or a reference area. Say let S be the reference area and L be the reference length, right? In order to calculate the moment, we need to have the reference length, right? You need a reference length, right? Force into that distance will become the moment. Now, in the above coefficients, we had a discussion on S and L. Say if this is an aircraft wing, so we can consider the span area, right? I hope you have already studied the span. This is the span. And the length of one tip to the other side tip is the span length that you already know, right? And here C is the chord. Of course, the chord may vary with respect to the location, different location of the wing. So the point here is S is the span and C is the chord, right? And sometimes it is mentioned as L, but we have a span length, we usually define the span length as B, right? B is the span length, B. Now, if we want to calculate a drag force or aerodynamic force on a sphere, then the consideration is S is the cross-sectional area and D is the diameter, right? Now we have coefficient of lift, coefficient of drag, coefficient of normal force, coefficient of axial force, and coefficient of moment. Okay. I pause at this point, and I would like to ask a question to all of you. Why we need to study the coefficients? Coefficient of coefficient of lift, coefficient of drag, and something like that. What is the necessity of studying the coefficients? Instead, I should have mentioned the lift force, drag force, normal force, axial force, and the moment. Instead, I am talking about the coefficients. Somebody can answer, or you can try.
Sir, the coefficients are like a ratio thing. When we can test a prototype and we could compare to a real model like that.
Good. Then, any other point? Anybody want to say?
Sir, these coefficients depend on the geometry of the airfoil or the wing. If we generally give force, means we can't identify the what kind of a wing it is, what kind of an airfoil.
Okay. Okay. Then, anything else? Just to speak, you are allowed to say wrong answer. Any other point?
Sir, maybe due to know the aerodynamic efficiency.
Of course. Aerodynamic efficiency is defined as coefficient of lift by coefficient of drag, or L by D, used for designing purpose, anaerobe. Yeah, good, correct. Then, okay, good. So, I would like to say the coefficient of lift, like who said that prototype and the real scale?
Sir, Vinod, sir.
Vinod, okay, Vinod, good. That's a nice point. So, in air, in the wind tunnel, I want to measure measure the lift force, drag force of a scaled down model of an airplane. Now, that airplane need to fly in the air, right? Say, let us say Boeing 747, I print a small shape, small body, right? Like a scaled down model. In our TBI, Technology Business Incubator, we can give the three-dimensional shape and they can print one for you. Now, if I measure the lift force and the drag force in the wind tunnel, that will not be same for the real airplane. But if I measure the coefficient of lift and coefficient of drag, the coefficient of lift and coefficient of drag, irrespective of whatever the scale, based on the shape of the geometry, it will become same. So CL for a small airplane, CL for a large airplane, having a similar airfoil, similar shape, the CL remains same, right? Okay, the CL and CD for the prototype, real model, experimental model, whatever it is, all the coefficient of lift and coefficient of drag becomes same. That's nice, Vinod said, that's correct. Now, is it the coefficient of lift and the coefficient of drag same for all the velocities? Okay, not the velocity. I can say another non-dimensional number here, a Reynolds number. You heard about Reynolds number?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So, Reynolds number is a ratio between inertia force to the viscous force. You write that as a rho V D by mu. So, with respect to Reynolds number, there may be a variation in CL and C, but not because of the shape. Right? So, we can happily say that coefficient of lift, coefficient of drag, coefficient of normal force, coefficient of axial force, coefficient of moment denotes the dimensionless form of force and moments for any aerodynamic body, which is scaled down or scale up, or whatever it is. Okay? Now, we had a discussion, right? So, the coefficient of lift, drag, and all those things. And I want to mention one point. In Anderson, we consider like this, right? The coefficient of lift, that is the capital L, capital D, and capital M, and A. It denotes the coefficient for the complete airplane, complete three-dimensional body, right? Complete three-dimensional body, complete airplane, complete wing. So C capital L denotes the coefficient of lift for the complete airplane. But what about CL, small l? Small l corresponds to the coefficient of lift of an airfoil. Say for example, for this whole wing, I can say the coefficient of lift is CL. But what about only for this particular airfoil? When you cut this particular location, you will see an airfoil, right? So if I mention C small l, then it is for only this airfoil. If C capital L, that is the notation we follow, right? Now say here it is CL, that is small l, and so this denotes the two-dimensional body, right? The lower case denotes two-dimensional body, the upper case denotes the full airplane or the whole airplane. Another point we need to remember, we had a discussion before probably in fluid mechanics and introduction to aerospace engineering. You have already studied the Bernoulli's theorem, right? From all those, we finally conclude that Cp is equal to P minus P infinity by Q infinity, right? So P infinity is a pristine static pressure and P is a total pressure. Q infinity is a dynamic pressure, right? Finally, Cp is a coefficient of pressure or pressure coefficient. Then skin friction coefficient is Cf. So tau is a shear stress and Q infinity is a pre-stream dynamic pressure, right? These two quantities also we need to remember, because this influences the, okay, so this influences the aerodynamic forces and moments, right? Now let us consider an airfoil, okay? And let us say this is not airfoil, this is of course a wing, right? Now you see, you have a x direction along the chord, right? And the y direction is perpendicular to the chord. Let us assume one small distance df, okay? Let us assume a small distance df. Now this is not not straight, right? Maybe it has some inclination with some angle probably. So let us say with respect to the horizontal, and this df makes an angle theta, okay? So I consider this elemental y as dy and the elemental distance in x direction as dx, okay? Now for the elemental distance ds on the airfoil, we would like to calculate the force and moments, right? So we can write dx, say if you want to say dx is equal to ds cos theta, and dy we can write as minus ds sin theta. And s is the span, and c into 1, I mentioned C into 1 because it is a unit chord, right? Or we can say if it is L, the whole length of the, I mean at least a span, so C into L. So C into 1 is a unit chord and C into L is for the whole span, okay? We can consider that. So if C into 1, then it is for this particular airfoil because L become unity. Now let us say we can write the equation, we can write it in the integral form. Cn is a coefficient of normal force and this is 1 over c is a chord, and I integrate 0 to c, right? Here it is 0 and here it is c, and I want to integrate this to 0 to c. Since it is a normal force, right, so we can consider the coefficient of pressure. L corresponds to lower and U corresponds to upper, right? Meaning is the pressure difference, right? The pressure difference on the lower surface and the pressure difference on the upper surface. How much lift force is acting here? It is the difference between the lower surface pressure and the upper surface pressure. So that is the term here, Cp lower minus Cp upper. Plus, this is the force we consider for coefficient of pressure or pressure distribution, and another component called the skin friction. Skin friction in upper and skin friction in lower. So this consideration, right, pressure force and the skin friction force, finally we can get the coefficient of normal force. And if you calculate it from C equal to 0 to C equal to C, means that we can divide this into number of elements, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, whatever you want. You can divide that and you can calculate and then integrate. Similarly, coefficient of axial force also we can calculate. The pressure force in the upper surface, pressure force in the lower surface, and again this is the coefficient of frictional force, right, in the upper surface, lower surface, and again we can come to the coefficient of moment, right, multiplied by a distance, multiplied by a distance, multiplied by a distance, distance, and finally have pressure, right, pressure force, shear force. So by evaluating all these integrals, right, we need to keep in mind that YU is directed above the x-axis. All the sign convention you can follow, right, all the mathematical sign convention we can follow, and finally we can arrive to the coefficient of normal force, coefficient of axial force, and coefficient of moment. Here the coefficient of moment LE denotes the coefficient of moment about the leading edge, right? We will see how it influences from the leading edge in the next class, right? So idea is the pressure distribution and the shear stress distribution contributes to the force and the moment. Now we already know L, we have calculated, right? Sometimes back we have discussed about L and N, right? Here L and N, L and D based on normal force and axial force. Now here we have same equation, right? And here the same equation CL. This is a lift force, but this is a coefficient of lift force, and this is a drag force, and here it is coefficient of drag. So we arrive to the conclusion of coefficient of lift and coefficient of drag, right? And some points we need to know, that the aerodynamic force and moment coefficients can be obtained by integrating the pressure and the skin friction coefficients over the body. So usually this is the procedure. Say for example, in the laboratory you measure the pressure on the surface, but you cannot measure the skin friction force in the laboratory, and hence whatever the drag you measure in the wind tunnel, we call that as a pressure drag, that's all, right? So this is a common procedure followed in theoretically as well as experimental aerodynamics, right? So, okay, in addition, our derivation have, we have used a two-dimensional body, right? And if it is a three-dimensional body, the equation will become little complex, that's all, right? So this is the way to calculate the aerodynamic forces and moments, okay? Probably from next class, we will go deeper into the mathematical aspects of the aerodynamic forces and moments and the basics involved, right? How we can wonderfully calculate the coefficient of drag, lift, theoretically, that we will study. In the laboratory, you will do that experimentally, okay? So, I think this is okay. I stop at this point, right? Thank you very much. And if you have some points, okay. If you have some, please let me know.